tonight I'm very excited to introduce Joseph LeDoux with his new book, Anxious. Joseph does not know this, but one of the reasons I'm quite excited about this is that his research and I go way back, and I have an undergrad in psychology. And so in my third year, I did take a course called Emotions and the Brain and had to read a lot of his work. And so this time when I was reading Anxious, it was sort of like a trip into my previous life. It was quite nice. You can probably deduce that from this that he's a brilliant scientist who published prodigiously on emotions and the brain in journals. And he's also the author of Emotional Brain and Synaptic Self. He's the Henry and Lucy Moses Professor of Science at NYU in the Center of Neuroscience and the director of the Emotional Brain Institute, which is a joint initiative of NYU and New York State. In addition to his research, he has other fascinating projects. For example, he collaborated with filmmaker Alexis Gambis on a project called My Mind's Eye on the Scientific American website, which is a series of interviews with scientists and philosophers that also featured music by Joseph's band, the Amygdaloids. And yes, indeed, he is also a singer and a songwriter. And while you should get a copy of Anxious because it is a delightful analysis of fear and anxiety, it also contains a code to download Anxious, the CD, which explores many of the same themes, but through song. And on this note, I guess, I will now pass the microphone to our guest. Please join me in welcoming Joseph LeDoux.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me back there? Great. This book really originated in the realization that about 30 years ago I made a mistake. And this has had a lot of consequences for the way I've done my work, and a lot of other people have done research for the psychology courses that he was studying and learning about. And I think ultimately our ability to study the brain depends on how well we understand what it is we're studying. So if we're trying to understand the neural basis of some psychological process, we need a really good understanding of how that process works. And not a simple-minded one, but a rigorous one that holds up under scientific analysis. And the problem is that the way we viewed emotions, I think, has been a bit off kilter, especially scientists. I think lay people basically understand what an emotion is, but scientists have sort of gotten it wrong. And what we've gotten wrong is that the, how many of you have seen Inside Out? Okay, so that typifies what's wrong. So we'll start there. So in Inside Out, there are these little emotions that control our behavior. So there's a little fear icon that is in your brain that's pulling strings to make you do things when you're in danger. There's a sadness icon, there's emoticon, I'm not sure what we'll call them, but these little bubbles that contain these emotional states that control our behavior. And this is the everyday kind of idea of emotions, really, that they control our behavior. This idea was formalized by Darwin in his book, Emotions in Man and Animals, when he talked about emotions as states of mind that have evolved to serve a purpose, which is a feeling, to allow us to respond in a certain way when we have that feeling. This is adaptive, and therefore animals survive and pass the genes that control these things on to their offspring. So the problem is, though, and this is something that William James picked up pretty soon after Darwin. James was a big admirer of Darwin, and he didn't frame this problem as an anti-Darwin problem, but in fact it was. He said, do we run from the bear because we're afraid, or are we afraid because we run? This was a famous quote, and many of you have probably heard it. Darwin's answer was that we're afraid because we run. In other words, that each emotion, like fear, has a kind of physiological signature in the body that makes its way back to the brain, and when the brain perceives that signature, that's where the feeling comes from. Now, that idea hasn't really held up that well, and it's the fact that it hasn't held up sort of overshadowed the fact that James really got one thing very important right when he said that we don't run from the bear because we're afraid of it. fear is not the cause of our emotional, so-called emotional responses that protect us. So you might be walking out, what is this, Connecticut Avenue out there? So you might be stepping out there and talking about the books. It's so exciting to hear about all this, right? And not paying attention to what you're doing. And then you find yourself jumping back because your brain was able to detect something fast and large moving towards you, move you back, and the bus or car goes flying by, and then you start to feel fear. So it's not fear that caused you to jump out of the way. Fear is a consequence in your conscious mind of having encountered this kind of event. Not necessarily because of the body feedback, as James said, but because of consequences within the brain as well as in the body. So that's a kind of long way of getting around to what I think the mistake I made was. But I still have to tell you more about something else before I get to the actual mistake. Because the ideas that I talk about in this book really go back to the work that I did when I was a graduate student. It all started then when I was studying patients who've had their brains split in half to control epilepsy. And one of my mentors in that project was Richard Nakamura, who's here tonight. He now works at NIMH, or NIH now, I guess. And we were both in the lab of Michael Gazzaniga studying. Richard was studying split-brain monkeys, and I was initially interested in that, but then the opportunity opened up to study split-brain patients, so I took that opportunity, even though it wasn't exactly what I wanted to do. I thought it was an interesting project, and I'm glad I did. So they're like, you probably know that when the brain is split in half to control epilepsy like this, and it's only done in very extreme, rare circumstances, you have two sides of the brain now that are somewhat independent of each other. And there are two findings that were really important in that from that research that we were doing at the time. One was that when we made the right hemisphere perform a response like wave, and we would then ask the left hemisphere, remember the left hemisphere is where language is in most people, including these patients. And so when you ask the patient a question, you're talking to the left hemisphere. The left hemisphere doesn't know anything at all about what's going on in the right hemisphere. It can't tell you anything. So if you put a picture of an apple into the right hemisphere by flashing it over into in a certain way that gets it to the right hemisphere, the patient will not report seeing anything. But if you put information in the right hemisphere that causes the patient to do something like stand up or scratch or any of a variety of other things, they will. You say, well, why did you do that? Why did you stand up, or why did you scratch your hand? And the patient would invariably tell us that an explanation for it. Well, I stood up because I needed to stretch, or I had an itch, so I scratched it. And so this led to the idea that this was part of my thesis, but really it was more of Mike's idea than mine. I was part of the project, so I got some credit for it. But it's an idea that really influenced the way I've thought about everything ever since. And that is that one of the things that our conscious minds does is create a story about who we are and what's going on in our lives. And it struggles to make a consistent story out of this. The psychologist Leon Festinger called this cognitive dissonance. When you have different things going on that don't fit, your mind tries to come up with an explanation and generate a reason for why these things go together. So when the patient was confabulating basically these explanations for why he was performing these responses, in other words, the left hemisphere is confabulating why the right hemisphere is performing the response, it's doing something that we think all of our minds do, which is our conscious minds, which is to create an interpretation or an understanding of what it is that's going on, because we don't have conscious access to most of what our brain does. Our brain is basically an unconscious machine, and only some of its activities percolate up into consciousness, those basically that we can focus our attention on. But otherwise, we don't really have access to those things that are going on. And one of the things that's very important are so-called emotional responses that are often generated by stimuli that go into the brain, are processed non-consciously by areas like the amygdala, which I've worked on for a long time, and generate responses in the body. And on the basis of those responses, we begin to tell a story about why we're responding that way. We use memory and anticipation as well as information in our brain. For example, when you have a threatening stimulus, your brain is aroused. Chemicals are being released that's activating all sorts of circuits, telling your attention systems to pay attention to what's happening in the environment because something important is happening. And all of a sudden you see that there's a thing out there that you know is dangerous, like a snake at your feet. You know that snakes can harm you. So you begin on the basis of perception, memory, and the kinds of feedback signals that are being generated by these unconscious systems, both within the brain and to the body and back to the brain, to interpret that state as the feeling of fear. So I got really interested in this topic of emotion in general through another kind of study that we were doing in split brain patients, which was we were putting information into the right hemisphere, but in this case it was an emotional stimulus. And when we put an emotional stimulus in the right hemisphere, the patient still couldn't tell us what it was, but it could rate the stimulus, could verbally rate the stimulus as good or bad. So he didn't know exactly what was out there, but he could give it a valence. He could indicate whether it was a good thing or a bad thing. So it turns out that in these patients, there was a connection in the brain called the anterior commissure that connects the parts of the brain in the two hemispheres, especially in the temporal lobe, where the amygdala is located. So the idea that we had there was that the amygdala in the right hemisphere was detecting the valence of the stimulus, sending that to the amygdala in the left hemisphere, and then that was providing some information that the left hemisphere's conscious mind could interpret and produce an explanation for. So when I left, after you graduate from a lab that's doing split brain research, you don't go set up your own split brain lab because there are only a handful of these patients, so you have to find something new to occupy yourself. And I fooled around with various things for a couple of years. I was studying language for a while and some other things in patients with brain damage. But then I decided I wanted to really go into this in more detail. And at the time, there were no techniques for studying the human brain in any formal, precise way in terms of functions, other than studying patients who had strokes or tumors and things like that. So I turned to animal research. In particular, I turned to rats because I knew about a procedure called Pavlovian fear conditioning, which seemed like a really great way to take a stimulus that has no meaning and give it a meaning. Basically what you do is you give a rat a tone, you then give it one shock, a mild shock, that's all you have to do, and the rat will then freeze, blood pressure and heart rate will go up, stress hormones will be released and so forth. So these are responses that are very similar, if not identical, to what happens when a human encounters a threatening stimulus. That's why we can study the rat brain and understand how it's responding to danger, even though rats and people are obviously threatened by different kinds of things. So this seemed like a good technique, and it was called fear conditioning. I initially was using it as a way to study emotion in general, but I quickly realized that, you know, maybe it was more about fear. And so I was just getting started on this work, and this is where the 30-year problem comes in. In 1984, I wrote a chapter in a book before I'd really done any research on the rat brain. I'd just been studying the behavioral aspects of this. And in that chapter, I had two things that I remember writing about. They were just sort of buried in there at the time. One was I predicted that there might be subcortical pathways from sensory systems that go into the amygdala to turn it on to produce these responses, because I knew about a lot of research in humans that had shown that you could present stimuli subliminally to a person, not a patient of any kind, but just a regular person with a normal brain. You can present stimuli very quickly, and so they're too quick to be consciously recognized, but the patient person can still show a physiological response to it. So you can sort of activate the fight-flight system inside the body. Blood pressure and heart rate go up and the palms sweat and so forth, even though the person has no idea that the stimulus was presented. So the idea there was that the stimulus was getting into the brain and triggering these responses, but wasn't going to the neocortex, which is important for our conscious awareness and our perceptions, conscious perceptions. So the idea then was that somehow the stimulus could get into the areas like the amygdala and trigger these responses without having to go through the cortex. And the other idea, though, was that that was one aspect of what was going on in a threatening situation. But the other aspect was that the stimulus was also going to the neocortex and separately giving rise to the conscious experience, the feeling of emotion that we have when we have these kinds of in these kinds of situations. So I'd propose these two systems: one, a conscious system that creates the feeling, and two, a non-conscious system that is producing the more automatic kinds of protective responses that are part of the, say, the fight-flight system. And so then I started doing research. And I've studied the what I did was I took that Pavlovian fear conditioning test and used it to study the unconscious system. In other words, the system that detects and responds to threats. Now, the problem was that even though I was saying that fear and other emotions were these cortical processes that are that involve the highest centers of the brain, the most newly evolved areas of the brain, I call the system that's detecting and responding to threats the fear system as well. So what I had in mind there was something that was emerging in the field of memory, which is that there are implicit memories and explicit memories. So explicit memories are conscious memories you have about, let's say you're in a dangerous situation. You'll have a conscious memory that, let's say you have an accident. So you have a conscious memory about where you were going, what you were doing, why you were in the car, and that this awful thing happened. But these are just sort of like factual things about the situation. Factual, you know, episodes in your life, but in a factual as opposed to a kind of intense emotional sense. Now, at the same time, you'll have these implicit memories that are involving other areas of the brain, like the amygdala, which is now known pretty much to be an implicit unconscious processor. So it detects and responds to the threat separately from the system that's giving rise to that feeling consciously. So you have stuff sort of under the hood and in the driver's seat, and to use an analogy, so to speak. But the mistake I made was calling all of that stuff fear. As I said, I had in mind sort of implicit fear and explicit fear. But the problem is, anytime you use the word fear, most people are going to think, unless you go through a long explanation like I'm doing now, most people are going to think you're talking about the feeling of being afraid, not these kind of unconscious processes. And this field has struggled with this distinction for a long time. My colleagues still talk about fear conditioning. I'm trying to change some of that language through this book and through some of my other writings, because I think it's leading in the wrong, leading us in the wrong direction. It's causing us to confuse two things that the brain is doing separately by labeling them in the same way. So, for example, partly as a result of my work, the amygdala has come to be thought of as the center of fear in the brain. That's the inside-out view that I was talking about. And I think this is completely wrong. The amygdala does not give rise to fear. When you turn on, when you have a threatening stimulus and it goes to the amygdala, fear does not percolate up out of the amygdala into your awareness. What the amygdala does is detects the threat and initiates the responses that help protect you. Now, at the same time, as I said earlier, that information is going to contribute to the feeling of fear by making its way into cortical areas and so forth, by way of the fact that the amygdala, for example, activates arousal systems that release these chemicals throughout the brain that make it more active and start attention focusing to the outside world and finding what's out there that's important, like a threat, activating memory systems, making them more efficient in their processing and so forth. And by making the brain in general more aware of what's going on at the moment, making the cortex more aware of what's going on. One of the things it becomes aware of is the fact that its non-conscious systems are revved up and that the body is responding in a certain way. So in that sense, we're all split-brain patients, that our brain is responding to stimuli non-consciously, And our conscious mind is telling a story, putting that together as an explanation for why we are responding this way. Now, one of the other issues that I discuss in the book that's perhaps a little controversial, we all have pets and we believe our pets are loving us, and they have fear and pain and sadness and all of the emotions we have. But, you know, the fact is there's no way we can know what another animal is experiencing. And if what I've been telling you is correct, that the feelings that we have are part of the highest parts of the brain that are involved in all this, then it's very unlikely that whatever experience is going on in a cat or a dog or whatever kind of animal you want to talk about has to be different from what's going on in our brain. Now, when we study something like fear in an animal, we're starting from our conscious minds. We're starting from our prefrontal cortex and its ability to conceptualize an idea like fear from all of the experiences that we've had with threats in our lives. So we're starting from the highest evolutionary point of the brain and using that to look back, trying to look back into millions and maybe billions of years of evolution into circuits that were programmed to do something different. And it just can't do that. We've got to start from the brain and let the brain tell us what these brain areas are doing, not our own conscious minds. Because in our mind, when we're afraid, we're also responding. So it's like, imagine something like a devil's food cake, you know, it's got chocolate cake inside and white icing on top. Once you have that sort of schema of what that cake is like, you can't imagine a devil's food cake that's any other way. It's the same thing with our emotions. Once we feel fear and are also experiencing all the stuff going on in our brain and body, we can't imagine that when that stuff that's going on in the brain and body occurs, it can occur separately from fear. That the everyday view that Darwin was promoting, that fear is a feeling that causes us to respond in a certain way, is what must be going on. But that is, I think, absolutely wrong. That the feeling of fear, once it exists, can, in fact, cause us we can, on the basis of fear, act in certain ways. But now we're switching gears here. We're talking about a distinction between reaction and action. So your brain first reacts to danger. The amygdala detects a threat and responds to it. But now, if you're a person or a rat, and you find yourself freezing in the presence of a threatening stimulus, you can't just stand there freezing forever. You have to decide what it is you're going to do. You have to make that transition from reaction to action. And so the first step in that is that your brain enters it what we can think of as a motivational state. And this is a non-conscious state that's been triggered by the threat and is a consequence of all that stuff that's going on in your non-conscious mind. What the threatening stimulus is doing is coordinating a lot of brain activity. In a dangerous situation, your brain has to be totally focused on staying alive. What you're conscious of at that moment is only the tip of the iceberg, as Freud said. What's really going on is that stimulus is coordinating all these various systems to allow you to protect yourself and stay alive. So within that state, that motivational state, we can call a defensive motivational state, you're now able to then perform responses that you've learned to do because of their success in dealing with harm in the past. So in psychology, we call this a difference between a sort of a reaction that's sort of pre-programmed or innate and a learned action that has been learned by its consequences, its reinforcing consequences. So a lot of the work that my lab currently does is in trying to study how the brain makes this transition from reaction to action and how it learns on the basis of the consequences of these behaviors. We study something called avoidance. Now, if you know anything about therapy for anxiety disorders, you know that avoidance is a bad thing. But I think that there's good avoidance and bad avoidance. Bad avoidance is when you are avoiding things altogether. But if you can engage with the threat and learn that it's maybe not quite as dangerous or harmful as you thought it was, or not as threatening as you thought it was, you can learn from that event to take the next step. So this idea came out right after 9/11. Jack Gorman, a psychiatrist, and I wrote a brief editorial in the American Journal of Psychiatry based on these rat studies we'd been doing, which showed that rats could learn to take these actions that were reinforced by the elimination of, or the control over, a cue that predicts harm. So the rats became very successful at engaging with the threat and doing things that controlled their exposure to it, preventing the threat from carrying out its bad things for them, as opposed to the rat remaining passive, getting out of the way altogether. So we can think of this as a sort of passive coping, which is the bad part of avoidance, as opposed to active coping, where you learn how to engage with the threat and successfully overcome it. So this is a lot of what we've been studying, and different circuits in the brain are involved, and we've been doing a lot of, as I said, most of our research now is focused on this particular problem. But let's go back to the fact that that these systems in the brain that are reactive, I want to focus on the reactive systems again, that these systems are innate systems. They're present in human brains, rat brains, frog brains, fish brains, bugs, slugs, worms, flies, you name it. Every animal has to be able to detect and respond to danger to stay alive. The circuits are going to be different in invertebrates and vertebrates, but in the vertebrate brain, the amygdala is key to this reactive process. But in the invertebrate brain, there are different kinds of circuits. But the most amazing part of all this is that even organisms that don't have brains or nervous systems have to do this as well. The bacterial cells living in your lower intestine have to be able to detect harm from safety in their chemical environment. They have these things called flagella that they wiggle, which can take them towards nutrients and away from harm. Now, all living organisms have to do five things in order to survive, probably many more, but at least five. One is to detect and respond to danger. In other words, we call that a threat detection function. Another is to incorporate nutrients and energy sources. So that's important for our feeding, for example. Another is balancing fluids, whether you're an individual bacterial cell or a complex organism, you have to keep your fluids in check in order for your physiology of your entire brain and body to work properly. Another thing is thermoregulation. All metabolic and biological functions of your brain and body depend on the temperature that's tightly controlled. So the organism, some organisms have to self-regulate their temperature by going in and out. We do that. We put on clothes, take off clothes as the temperature changes, for example. And finally, in order for the species to survive, you have to reproduce. These five things, as I said, are present and characteristic of bacterial cells and every other organism between humans and bacterial cells. And other single-cell organisms. So these are not, these things, if you study them in a mammal, these are the things you would study to understand certain emotional behaviors, like what we call fear conditioning, or what you might think of as appetitive behaviors, or food-seeking behaviors, or sexual behaviors. So these are all the things that animal psychologists and human psychologists want to understand about the basic driving forces, motivations of our minds and brains. But they don't exist to make motivations and emotions. Their purpose is to keep the organism alive. A bacterial cell doesn't have fear and love and sadness. It just has life. So if you take these five things and put them into a brain that can be conscious of its own activities, then you get the psychological experience, the feeling of fear, the feeling of anger, love, sadness, and all of the other feelings that we experience. But these things are not pre-wired into your brain, into your amygdala or other parts of the brain because of these more innate systems. They're psychologically made on the spot on the basis of memory, on the basis of perception, and on the basis of feedback from these signals in your body and brain. So one way to think about this is by way of analogy with making a soup. So let's say you've got a pot and you put in water and carrots and onions and maybe green peppers. And then you say, well, what kind of soup am I going to make? Okay, so you put chicken in. So now it begins to take on a certain character. And I'm from Louisiana, so I would typically put roux in to make a gumbo. But if you're from somewhere in the East, you might put in curry paste, and it begins to take on a different kind of character. So in addition to the character of the soup, though, you can intensify the flavor with things like salt and pepper and so forth. And emotions are like this, too. They each have a character that's based on ingredients, and they have factors that also can intensify them, like arousal in the brain. Now, the different ingredients, though, whether you're making soup or making emotions, let's just talk about soups first. These are not soup ingredients. They don't exist in nature to make soup. But when they're put together in a certain way, you get soup of a certain character and intensity. And the same is true of emotions. The ingredients in the brain that make emotions are not emotional ingredients. They're things that exist for other purposes. Arousalism is there to regulate our sleep-wake cycles and our alertness while awake. It's not there to make you feel intensely afraid. But if your brain has constructed a sense that there's something dangerous out there, and you know from all of your experiences in life and all of the times that when you were a child and you encountered something dangerous and your parents said, oh, that you must have been so afraid, or when you were in school and had to give a presentation for the first time or stand up in front of the class for the first time, someone may say, oh, that must have made you really anxious. You begin to learn what these words mean, and you form these templates or schema in your brain that relate to those words. And so you draw upon those memories, those schemas, every time you encounter a threat. But that threat is going to do two things. It's going to go to your innate systems to produce these innate responses that we've been talking about. But it'll also go to your cortex, activate those schemas, which you'll then apply to your present experience, which can be then intensified by the arousal that the amygdala is generating by activating these modulatory chemical systems. So that's my basic idea about what we've got right and wrong. We don't have these little packets of emotion in the brain waiting to be unleashed by a threat. Emotions are psychological experiences that are put together on the basis of memories, on the basis of ingredients that are being generated non-consciously and being interpreted in light of these memories that we've had and so forth, and that's how our emotions come into be. Now, one advantage of this view over other views is that in the standard way to talk about emotions is you have these basic innate emotions like fear and anger and disgust and so forth that are of one type, and then you have these so-called social emotions or complex emotions or secondary emotions like pride and envy and so forth that are more kind of psychologically constructed the way I've been talking about. But I think that what I'm trying to say is that all emotions are psychologically assembled like this. There are no basic emotions. There are no feelings that are wired into your brain. Feelings are psychologically made on the basis of ingredients that happen to be innate and are wired into your brain. But those are just systems that are not in the brain to make emotions, but to do other things, namely to keep you alive. And when your brain has the capacity, if you have a brain that has the capacity to be aware of its own activities, then you can have the feeling of fear. Now, in order to have what we would typically call a feeling of fear and to experience that, you have to have something beyond simply the representation of a threat. You have to have a concept of you, of I, that this thing is happening to me and that it's my life that may be on the line. And if your brain cannot create that concept of me, then you can't have that kind of experience. So that's another reason why it's very difficult to make this transition from human emotions to animal emotions, because we don't know that they have that capacity to have a self-concept, because the concept of I is so tied to the word I. Without the word I, it would be hard for you to know how to hang on to that idea. You have a name. there's so much that we, so much that of our psychological experience that depends on the language that we have. We have more than 36 words in English to categorize different varieties of fear and anxiety, different states: fear, horror, terror, trepidation, consternation, panic, and on and on. 36 of those things. That, you know, you have to have language to know the difference between trepidation and fear. And without that, it doesn't make any sense. You can't have a trepidation center, a fear center, a consternation center, a panic center, and so forth. The brain's just not wired like that. The brain is wired to do certain mechanical things like detect threats and respond to them, and also to psychologically piece together experiences in our conscious minds. And that's one of the advantages of the human brain that we understand, that we're beginning to understand, is how these conscious states come into existence. So 10 or 15 years ago, consciousness was sort of taboo in psychology, maybe 20 years ago. But now it's coming into both psychology and neuroscience in a great way. And I think we're beginning to understand a lot about it. And once we do understand consciousness, we'll understand what emotions are. So basically, I'm saying that we need to think about a lot of things in different ways than we've been doing it traditionally in the field. So let me close with some of the implications of this for things like psychotherapy and our understanding of mental disorders. Let me start by talking about the way new drugs are developed to help people who have problems with fear and anxiety. So typically, this started in, let's go back. So in the 1960s, the benzodiazepines were discovered. This would include Valium, Xanax, drugs like that, Klonopin. So these drugs are very effective in making people feel less fearful or anxious in certain situations. But they have lots of side effects. So drug companies try to develop newer and better drugs to do these things. And then, of course, the SSRIs are also used to treat certain kinds of anxiety disorders, even though they're technically antidepressants. You know, we basically have a couple of drugs for psychiatric problems that are used in almost everything. So it's hard to know exactly what to call these different drugs. But as new drugs are attempted to be discovered that have fewer side effects and that might be more effective in people, mice or rats are put into challenging situations where they're threatened in some kind of way, either by a novel, unexpected environment, or by something they've learned about that's dangerous and so forth. And what the experimenter then tries to do is study whether the animal is less timid, so to speak, in that situation. Is it less inhibited? Will it explore more in that situation? Or will it stay frozen all the time? If the drug makes the rat stop freezing and start exploring more, then it's assumed that the rat or mouse is less fearful, less anxious, and therefore if you give the drug to a person, they should be less fearful or less anxious as well. But with all of these new drugs, the results have been very disappointing. And as a result of that, big companies like GlaxoSmithKline are getting out of the anti-anxiety business because they aren't having any success in finding drugs that are making people feel less fearful and anxious. But maybe we've thought about what these drugs are doing wrong. What the drugs are doing when they make an animal less inhibited in one of these challenging situations is acting on these threat defense systems in the brain and making so the rat is now able to act in a certain way that it couldn't act before. So it's freezing less. So when you give the drug to the person, what do you find? Well, the person with social anxiety is now more capable of going to the party, but still feels fearful and anxious when they get there. Because what the drug is doing is exactly what it was designed to do by the experimenter, but it was interpreted wrong in terms of what it's going to achieve. So you have to do the animal research because we learn about the fundamental mechanisms. But we need to understand what it is we're studying when we study animals and not assume that just because our brain experiences fear when we're threatened and also responds in this way. That if another animal is responding that way, it's also feeling fear. And if we change the way it responds, it's also going to feel less fear. So, you know, I think we have a lot, we could continue along the same path we've been doing and make a lot of important discoveries still. But if we have a crisper understanding of where we're going as we go forward, I think we can make a lot more progress. So we need to be able to think about these things correctly, because not only are drugs being developed on the basis of these ideas, or attempted to be developed, but also people are being treated. I get lots of emails from patients and therapists telling me that they use the emotional brain or synaptic self, and maybe now anxious, to go through the therapeutic process with their patients. So they read it, they try to figure out, well, you see that when you're afraid, your amygdala is activated, and therefore that's why you're feeling fear. So this is why I feel I have to own up to the mistake I made, because I think it's having important consequences as to the way therapy is being conducted, the way mental disorders are being conceived, and I want to get it right. It's been like this imperceptible itch that's needed scratching for many years, and I finally gotten to the point where I need to do something about it, and this book is the consequence. So towards the end of the book, I talk about some of the ways that neuroscience might help revise the way therapy is being done. So I think anyone who's ever been in therapy would agree that it's, you know, while you may benefit from it, there's obviously room for improvement. It doesn't help everyone, and even those that are helped, it doesn't help them as much as they would like in many cases. So what can we learn about the brain and therapy from studies of animals, for example? Let me put it in terms of the kind of therapy that is most easily related to the brain, which is cognitive behavior therapy or exposure therapy. Now, exposure therapy is based on the principle of extinction, which was discovered by Pavlov in the, you know, early part of the 20th century. And what extinction is when you give a stimulus over and over again after that. Let's say we've got Pavlov's dog, and he's rang the bell and given the meat. And so now when he brings the bell, the dog will salivate. So that's a conditioned reflex. Now, if you present the bell without the meat over and over again, the dog stops salivating. Same thing with a threatening stimulus. If you condition a rat to a tone that's been paired with a shock, and now you present the tone over and over again without the shock, the rat stops responding, stops freezing to the tone, because it learns that the tone is no longer threatening. So so in exposure therapy, what you're doing is finding out what it is that's bothering the person by talking to them, and figuring out what's on their minds and why they're there. So the person may feel fearful and anxious and say that the reason that they're fearful and anxious is because of some event that happened to them, or they don't know why they're fearful or anxious, but often there's an explanation, sometimes there's not. But the therapist will then look for kind of the core of the problem. Find, let's say, there was an accident at some point. So the therapist would then expose the patient to cues related to accidents and have discussions about accidents and so forth to weaken those responses. Now, the problem with this kind of exposure therapy is that both in animals and humans, when you do extinction, the responses almost always come back under stress and other as a result of other consequences. So it's a temporary fix. So one goal would be to try and figure out ways to make exposure therapy more effective. So I think one of the things that we need to think about in doing this, though, is that exposure therapy, as it's typically done, is not extinction. We know a lot about the brain mechanisms of extinction, and many people then assume that the brain mechanisms of extinction are the brain mechanisms of exposure therapy. But that's wrong, because exposure therapy is extinction plus an awful lot of talk therapy, relaxation training, coping skill training, and a lot of other things go on. So it's unfair to then try to look for the basis of exposure therapy on the basis of having studied extinction. So I think what we need to do is, again, it's as I've been talking about, we need to dissect things better scientifically, and separate processes that we were labeling in a certain way that assumes that they're together in the brain, but in fact they're different things, and we need to find those differences and study them separately. So one thing we've learned is that just through studies of learning and memory is that cramming is very bad. So if your students who study for an exam an hour before the exam don't do as well as those who've spent the same amount of time studying but over a more extended period of time. So studies in animals have shown that the reason that that is the case is because cramming, or what's called mass training if you're doing animal experimentation, depletes a thing in the brain that's important, an enzyme that's important for the formation and stabilization of memory. So once that enzyme is depleted, you need about an hour to replenish it. But if you do the training over a more relaxed pace, then the enzyme doesn't get depleted and the memories are more effectively stored. A therapy session where exposure is being done is basically a cramming session. So you need to figure out how to do this in a less confined way. One way is to extend the time. Now, that becomes a problem because therapy sessions are 50 or 60 minutes, depending on the therapist. So, and the insurance company won't pay for a longer session. So I'm not talking about things that are practical. What I'm saying is therapy is not perfect, and here are some reasons why it might be better. Oh, I'm supposed to stop now. So let me just quickly go through these. And so one would be to extend in time. We know also that things that happen after learning interfere with the formation and storage of memories. So the patient should have a time after the session to consolidate the memories, be given tasks that are non-interfering with the formation of the memory, but at the same time prevent rumination. We also know that sleep is an important thing for consolidating memories. Maybe therapy sessions should take place at 10 o'clock at night. Then the person sleeps overnight in the therapist's extra bedroom. On and on like that. Also, in studies that we've done in my lab, we've shown that if we take simple extinction, and instead of doing it one trial after another, this was a mistake that was made by a student, but turned out to be an important mistake. If you separate the first trial from the second trial of extinction by a little time window, then the responses never pop back up in the rat. So then Daniela Schiller and Liz Phelps tried the same thing in human subjects that have been conditioned in the laboratory. These are not patients, just subjects. And the responses never came back, just as we did in the rats. Then some researchers at NIH, I think at NIDA actually, and collaborating with researchers in China, tried this in drug-addicted rats, gave the rats a cue that had been related to drug relapse, and the rats no longer relapsed if they did the extinction the way that we did it in the other studies. So they said, let's try this in humans. So they gave this procedure to humans either using the separation method or the standard method. And what they were testing is relapse to paraphernalia cues and so forth. And the addicts that had the separation method did not relapse in the presence of the cues, but the addicts who had the standard extinction did relapse. So these simple kinds of things that we're learning about through animal research are very important for not only, furthering our understanding of how the brain works, but also have important consequences for how we conceive of problems that people have in adapting and coping in life, and also how we might help treat them better. So thank you very much. Sorry, I took so long.
Hi. Isn't it true that the talk therapy, psychotherapy, just as a supplement to a pharmacological regimen, because the basic neurotransmitters are like the serotonin, dopamine, all those things are the reasons for this kind of a fear, anxiety, and sadness. And so isn't it SSRI? Successfully, not successfully to the 100%, to some extent, had done so much to those people with this kind of a illness But the psychotherapy you mentioned about that, of course, it supplements, but alone it won't help the patients. Do you agree with that?
So I think I didn't really get to finish all of the whole wrap here, but one of the important things is that you have to change what's under the hood and what's on top of the hood as well. So the drugs may be effective in suppressing the threat response system, and that could be useful because then you can address the through cognitive therapy and talk therapy, the conscious feelings. Both have to be addressed. If you only deal with one, the remaining one will reactivate the other. So an important way to address the implicit reactive systems, the threat systems, without drugs, though, is to do subliminal exposure. Present the condition stimulus or the threatening stimulus to the patient subliminally so the patient doesn't, the conscious mind doesn't know the stimulus is there. Weaken the amygdala and other systems implicitly, tricking the conscious mind because it's not going to know what's going on, and then do psychotherapy on the conscious mind. So I think we have to take another question. Sure.
You speak of decoupling the motivational and the feelings. It seems to me like that's really what happens when someone meditates. Is that do you have support for that as being a kind of therapy?
Well, I don't do research on that, but I do talk about that towards the end of the book. And the conceptualization of meditation that I offer is that, you know, we usually think of working memory, which is, you know, prefrontal cortex and other cortical areas, kind of a workspace where we hold information in mind and think about it and attend to things. And the role of attention is to bring information into working memory. But attention is a control system, and it can keep stuff out of working memory as well. So one way that meditation might work is by learning how to, from within working memory, to harness attention, to encapsulate working memory so that you can be in a sort of totally internal state, so kind of selfless, environmentalist state, and do what it is that those thoughts that you're going to. I don't meditate, so I don't really know what I'm talking about, but it's just an idea I had. Yes? No.
I wanted to find out how the model of emotions, which you described, how would it explain empathy? And a related question, how would it work with neurodiverse people, like, for example, autistic people? Would it work the same way, or the signals would be different? And the related question, but somewhat different but related, is about language. You mentioned that language is necessary, which seems natural, but how would it work with people who actually have language impairment?
Okay, so you asked a lot. I want to especially address the last point, because it's not about words. It's not about the expression of language. It's about the cognitive architecture that language brings into the human brain and allows us, words are important, but also we have syntax. So with syntax, the human brain can simulate in a fraction of a second, in a social situation, who's going to do what to whom, because you can have the subject, the object, the action, and so forth. So it's a very important thing that we have that other animals don't have. They have to learn through trial and error how to parse these kinds of social situations. In terms of empathy, you know, most of our social interactions take place between our unconscious minds. The conscious mind, you know, that we are, you know, we kind of live in our conscious minds. But when two people are interacting, it's, you know, it's the body language, it's the subtle cues, the implicit factors that are going on under the hood there that are making the situation work or not. And the conscious mind is picking up cues from that. So empathy, I think, is largely an unconscious process that filters into consciousness, and we have some sense of it. But I think a lot of that is going on underneath. Empathy is important because it gives rise to anthropomorphism as well. So we empathize not only with people, but with animals. And that goes back to the devil's food cake thing, where once you have this concept that you have these feelings because you're acting in a certain way, if another animal has those feelings, it's hard to imagine they aren't, if it has those actions, it's hard to imagine they aren't feeling that. Now, I'm not saying animals have no conscious experiences, no feelings. I'm saying we don't know, we don't have a clue as to what they're actually feeling. All we have is their behavior to tell us that their implicit systems are reacting. A dog lying on the ground writhing in pain, we think it's feeling the pain we feel, but actually a tissue damaging stimulus goes into your brain and does a variety of things, only one of which is that experience of the feeling of pain. It's also going to be motivating different systems, eliciting reflexes, and three or four different things that have nothing to do with the feeling of pain. So the writhing on the ground of the dog is a reflex response. That doesn't indicate that anything about feeling. So I'm not saying that animals have no feelings. I'm just saying it's a tremendous problem. And if we start from the assumption that they have the exact feelings we do or something similar, it just gets in the way of actually making progress. What we need to do is understand what's similar about the animal brain and the human brain rather than looking for human emotions in animals.
I have a question. How is your work related to preparing individuals who are going to fearful situations like the military? Right. Or firefighters, and does it or can it help in preventing PTSD?
Right. The question is, how does this work relate to people that are being trained in the military, or firefighters, and does it help understand and treat PTSD? You know, I think that again, that's that. There are, I think, there are a lot of implications. It'll be hard to say it in a quick way, but some of the work we've done has been focused on the so-called erasure of memory. By that, we're not erasing the conscious memory that the person has of a trauma, for example, but instead we're erasing the implicit, the memory stored in the implicit memory systems like the amygdala, so that the under the hood stuff is less troubling. But the person still remembers the trauma, but there's not drawn into a panic attack when they experience it. There are other things, like a lot of the work we do involves norepinephrine in the brain, and so we're studying how that chemical works in the amygdala, for example. And one of the things we've discovered is that drugs like propranolol, which work on norepinephrine, and they've been used to try and stop the formation of memories after trauma, in the amygdala, they actually have no effect if you give them after the trauma. You have to give them before the trauma in order for them to work. And that's why these emergency room treatments with propranolol are not being very effective. But if there were, you know, if you had had people like firefighters who you knew had to go into a situation, you might consider pre-treating with propranolol or something like that. But then there are other issues. Would you interfere with performance? Or would you somehow mess up their memories of the situation? So there are lots of ethical and practical questions. But there's also a possible explanation of why those things are not working the way they would like to work.
Last question. Oh, I just wondered if you could clarify something that you were talking about at the end about implications for the practice of therapy. And in addition to having sleepovers at the therapist's house, the idea of somehow putting a separation, a standard approach, and then a separation between the interventions or something, I didn't understand that, and I just wondered if you could talk more about what that sort of looked like.
Well, in an exposure therapy session, you give the stimulus over and over again. So in the lab, what we discovered was that if we, because it was a mistake was made, the student gave the first trial, and then something happened, and she had to go do something. Someone called her or something, so she left. And it took about 10 or 15 minutes to get back. And so then she did the rest of the extinction. Because she did that for this small group, she did the rest of the experiment that way. And then accidentally, resulted in the fact that the freezing responses never came back in the rats when they were extinguished.
So these are very short separations.
Yes, because what happens is that first trial activates something called reconsolidation of memory. It activates neurochemicals in the brain that are involved in the opening up of a memory window where memories that you had in the past can now be changed. You need 10 minutes for that process to kick in, and then you have 4 hours to complete it. So if you do one trial, wait 10 or 15 minutes, then do the rest of the extinction within 4 hours, then the memories stay suppressed. But if you do it all at once, the memories will pop back up.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you all. If you buy the book, in the book is the download code for the Anxious CD. Listen to the music.